In this tutorial, I'll show you how to perform at least microsecond precision timing on Windows and C. I'll also show the two main applications for such timing, which are measuring code performance and rate limiting, like limiting your game's render loop to 60 Hz. Modern CPUs have an internal counter which increments at a fixed rate, so all we need to do is find out how many times that counter increments per second, then we can get the value of that counter at any time and divide by the tick rate to get time measurements. The two functions we'll use are Query Performance Frequency and Query Performance Counter from Windows.h. Both functions use Windows' large integer type, which is a union used here as a 64-bit signed integer. To extract the N64 from the union, we access the quad part member. We call Query Performance Frequency, passing a pointer to our frequency variable to be filled, and print the result. Next, we call Query Performance Counter a couple of times and print out the values. To demonstrate calculating an elapsed time between two QPC calls, here I'm subtracting A from B and dividing by frequency to calculate the elapsed seconds. That's all you need for timing, and it doesn't take much to turn this into a code performance measuring tool. Here's what I've come up with. Zen Timer. Anyone get the reference? The init function gets the tick frequency, and start creates a new timer structure and gets the starting tick count. N takes an existing timer, gets the ending tick count, and returns the real time in microseconds between beginning and end. Here's an example usage of Zen Timer. We include ZenTimer.h, initialize Zen Timer, start a new timer and store it locally, do something we want to time, then end the timer, recording the return time locally. Lastly, we print out the time. Zen Timer can easily be inserted into whatever existing Windows code you have to measure code performance. Now on to rate limiting. What we want to do is set a target amount of time for each update, renderer, or whatever. Then time how long the iteration takes and wait until we've reached the target amount of time. Here's a simple program demonstrating that. Since our timing functions use ticks, we calculate the amount of ticks per loop by taking the amount of ticks per second and dividing by the number of loops we want to run per second, in this case 5. We get a starting tick count, then proceed through our loop. In this case, our loop just prints out the loop count, which, without a rate limit, could easily run thousands of times a second. So we run this while loop checking the current time until the difference between start and current has exceeded the target number of ticks per loop. Then set the starting ticks to the current ticks. This delay loop gets the job done, but it will exceed the target amount of time by a tiny bit and constantly uses the CPU while waiting. We can solve the overshoot by, instead of setting start to current, adding the ticks per loop to start. This way, even if one wait loop overshoots by a bit, that amount will be compensated for in the next loop. However, if our thread gets locked for, let's say, a full second, each preceding loop won't wait at all until we've added the ticks per loop amount to the start variable enough to catch up to all the time that's passed. To fix that, we can cap the difference between start and end to one loop's worth of ticks, so that small overshoots in our loop and wait runtime can be compensated for, and large overshoots like a temporary thread freeze will act like the program was paused for that period. You can tune these values depending on the performance and requirements of your program. I've added this code to randomly sleep for 1 second to simulate thread freezes, and we can see that the program freezes, then continues running at the normal rate. Instead of a spin lock, we'd rather put the thread to sleep and let Windows wake it back up when the time has elapsed, so that we can let the CPU cool off between loops instead of melting the thing. The best Windows gives us is the sleep function, which takes a time in milliseconds to sleep for. By default, sleep is actually only accurate to around 15 millisecond intervals, so calling sleep 1 will way overshoot. We can increase precision using time begin period from mmsystem.h. We now also need to link to WinMM. Time begin period sets the thread timing resolution to a number of milliseconds, so we set it to 1 since that's the lowest. Until Windows 10 version 2004, this set the system-wide timer resolution and therefore increased CPU and power usage even after closing your program. So be sure to call time end period with the same value at the end of the program. Since that Windows version, this is now handled per process and is no longer a problem for most users. So we calculate the number of milliseconds to sleep by taking the target number of ticks, subtracting the current ticks, then dividing by ticks per millisecond. Then we sleep for that time. Now we can sleep with millisecond precision, though it's still inaccurate, often missing by 1 millisecond and occasionally more than that. If you want the most accuracy, you can sleep for an amount of milliseconds a few less than needed, then use a spin lock for the rest. And if you want the least CPU usage, you can sleep to the nearest millisecond and let the 0 to 3 milliseconds of inaccuracy get absorbed in the next loop sleep cycle. How you choose to tune that depends on your program requirements. One extra optimization is that calling sleep 0 is a kind of hidden feature which sleeps for the remainder of the current time slice. There's no guarantee how long that will be, but in my testing it's around 30 microseconds. By using this in a spin lock, you could reduce your CPU usage without losing any meaningful amount of precision. That's how to do precise timing, performance measuring, and loop frequency limiting in C on Windows, and this one really was a blast to make. Soon I'll be starting my series of tutorials on how to make a small game in C. Cheers!